now.
Mm-hmm.
Go for it.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping.
Good evening and welcome. This is Maris at Midnight, and tonight I am joined by Tambre and John, and we are having a very intense discussion into identifying darkness.
Light will always overcome darkness. This doesn't mean that darkness won't attempt to overcome the light.
Very true. We were just talking about today, part of our group went to a local state park. It's called Roman Nose State Park. And we went there on a twofold reason: to do a little reconnaissance for some future events and festivals, and also to do a little wild crafting and look for some of our sacred herbs and plants that we use here in our healing, and as well as when we do many of our different missions, you know, such as house cleansings. And Tambre does a lot in the paranormal world, and so we like to go out to Roman Nose because it's very, very spiritual, sacred grounds, and brings a lot of love and light into there. And she made me giggle here as I was telling her that when we, you know, we had a very uneventful drive there. It was a really pleasant drive, and we're driving around looking for different spots, and we go up Deer Run. In fact, I'm the one that said, "Oh, Deer Run, let's go there." And so the next thing you know, we're plucking up the and Aileen's driving, and she's driving her van, you know, so we're going up this hill, and it's kind of muddy, and we notice that there's this little crack. I'm going to call it a canyon. You know, anything that's more than 2 inches wide is a canyon on a road, right? And so we're trying to figure out how to avoid the canyon, and so we figured, well, if we go to the left, because there's no canyon on the left, and we get stuck. So between Felicia, Daniel, and myself, we like push the car out, or the van out, and we start going downhill, and we get stuck again. And, you know, I'm like, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. So baby girl and I are walking down the hill, and we're doing Choku Ray down the hill, you know, because we're going to get out of this rut. And as we're doing Choku Ray, these guys in this truck come up, and they're taking pipes down to this other little area that's along the same road. And fortunately, those two country boys, I like country boys, just saying, these two country guys help us get out of the rut and back onto a non-muddy road, thank goodness. You know, have a couple little things that, you know, kind of occurred. Everybody saw their spirit animal out there but me. My spirit animal is a turtle. Do I see a turtle? No, I do not see a turtle, but they see a tarantula. They see a frog. They see a hawk. And I'm like, where's mine? Everybody gets their spirit animal but me. And then, of course, on the way home, we hit a, you know, no reason in the world, we get a flat tire. It's like almost a brand new tire. We can't even tell what's wrong with the tire when we take it off, but it's as flat gets. So you're right. Mm-hmm. When you made that comment about light always supersedes that darkness.
You know, we're all faced with darkness at one point in our lives, but we have to look at the situation that surrounds the darkness. Just like with you today, look at your purpose and your intent for going out to Roman Nose. It was very spiritual. You guys went out there for multiple reasons, but look at what happened when you were coming back. You guys were blessed at your visit out there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely.
And when you were coming back, so you were surrounded by light, but then coming back, that darkness was attempting to feed off of your light. Light is another word for God's promise.
Definitely.
So I just think that it was trying to snuff your life a little bit and take away some of your joy.
No, I was like, and you know what? It actually, the funny part is that it didn't take away my joy. And I know that my husband's going to listen to this because he tells me that he listens to these. Sometimes I'm frustrated with him, and I don't think that he, like, attends to my needs like I need him to. And, you know, it's kind of like, dude. And what was the comment everybody made? Because, I mean, I text messaged him, and then I called him. And he's like, where are you? And I tell him exactly where I am. And the next thing you know, it was like a couple of minutes later, he's there. And they're like, your husband's fast. And I'm like, no, he's not. I have to tell him 15 times. And then I was like, holy cow, he was very attentive to my needs today. So there is some lightness there, you know. If anything, the darkness just allowed me to see that my husband is attentive.
And it was not an accident. It was meant to be. He was, what, 8-10 minutes away from you?
He ended up working in Yukon.
Yeah, so, yeah. You know, things just worked out. The angels, guides, God put everything in motion to be there to supersede that darkness.
And that's what's, you know, really kind of, I think that we sometimes forget about that. Mm-hmm. That the lightness is, the light is always there present, but sometimes we have our eyes closed.
We do.
I was, you know, often people will come in and they have difficulties appreciating what light means. And I think that there's for me, in my perspective, I think that there's a couple of different paths on that. I think that you have people that are born in the light and are raised in the light and always live in the light. And that is a very beautiful experience. Then you have people that are born in the light, but they're not raised and nurtured in the light.
Right.
And then maybe they come to the light later on in life. And then you have people that were, you know, born and raised in the light. And then as adults, they go. And you have people that are born in the darkness and always stay in the darkness.
Right.
And then it's not until very late that maybe they might have that conversion. But so I think sometimes people have a difficulty in identifying what darkness is.
I agree.
And what it looks like, how it manifests. You had lent me the name of the book, and I'm so sorry, I forgot the name of the book. But it's by the very famous exorcist, Father Amor.
Yes.
And he is a Vatican exorcist, very, very well known, etc. And so I'm reading his book, and it was really weird. And I'm going to tell the story, and then we'll get into this. But as everybody knows, that I kind of like to practice some different things in my past. And there was a particular style of magic, I'll just say magic, that I practiced, and I did a spell. And this spell, for practical purposes, was very successful. But remember, spells always have a consequence to it. And so we get married, and we get this like new apartment and new furniture and all this new stuff. And within our first month of being married, this is why, girls, you don't do love spells like this. Our brand new apartment, which is a brand new building, has a major cockroach infestation. And so when I'm reading this book, talk about accountability coming and getting you. I'm reading this book, and Father is in there talking about some of the signs of satanic or devil manifestations, talking about when people frequent, you know, the fortune tellers, blah, 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 that often they will start experiencing this. And it was cockroaches was one of the first thing he talks about. And I'm like, holy cow, I caused that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there were other little things that had occurred, and those are for other stories for other days. But I was like, something so, which, you know, I'm thinking at the time, you know, this is 30 years ago. Okay. I'm not the same girl.
Who's counting?
Yeah, really. You know, so I'm sitting here thinking the whole time, like, holy cow, what choices did I make?
Right.
And the accountability that you have with it. And I was like, some people make a choice and they never come to the light about it and release it and heal and whatever. And I was like, can you imagine carrying that burden of darkness all of your life?
And we can always go in and add the title of the book, because I think it's definitely a must read for anybody and everybody. I know one of the things that I certainly took away from the book is that lightness means different things, even just like darkness does for different people. You know, people are looking for something, and you know, so what might be light to one person is not going to necessarily be the same thing for someone else.
Very true.
To me, light is truth, it is honesty, and it is a promise. It is a promise that was made, a divine promise made to all of us. So, you know, that's my take on it.
Yeah.
What about you, John?
Well, the whole idea with being accountable and with everything, that a lot of people don't even realize that when you make an agreement or an arrangement with somebody and you break that agreement and you don't fulfill it and you don't take accountability for that, that just adds on another link in the chain that you're dragging along, like Linda was talking about, of, you know, different energies of darkness that are hanging on to you. Well, that's part of it. When you break an agreement and you don't acknowledge you broke it, then it just keeps adding up, and eventually something's going to key in and it will start spiraling you downhill. And then you're wondering, why am I like this? Why is my life going like this? Well, it's because you've made so many agreements or arrangements and you've broken them. And it could be something as easy as, oh, I'll pick that up for you from the store, and then you don't go do it. That's breaking an agreement. That's another link to the chain.
Yeah, that's true. You know, somewhere, in fact, if it's okay, I'm going to quote in the Bible. It does say Isaiah 60:1-3 says, arise, shine, for your light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Usually it takes something really, really significant to happen in our lives for our light to shine the brightest. And we have to really see that darkness for us to make that decision to get up and out of the darkness to really shine through our light.
I agree with that. The name of that book by Father Amore is Exorcist Explains the Demonic.
Yes.
And that's an excellent book. I think that everybody who's ever going to... And when I say delve into the darkness, doesn't mean that you're like engaging or embracing. It means that you're trying to understand what that means and the significance of being able to identify what is darkness or what is evil in that. And that's the very important aspect of it. Going back to that that concept of always living in light and never knowing what darkness is. You know, I'm going to throw Eve under the bus on this one. Because in many ways, that was where Adam and Eve, you know, when you think metaphorically in the in scripture, they lived in nothing but light and love.
Right.
Everything was beautiful and wonderful, and, you know, all their needs were met, and, you know, and everything was groovy. And then all of a sudden, you know, this man, and I'm going to just say this man, I really don't know if it was a serpent. But I look at it, so you have this man that comes in and starts planting seeds of doubt, and those seeds of doubt create a darkness, because then they're questioning the light. Mm-hmm. They're questioning that, not so much the existence of it, because they know it exists because they've experienced it, but then they fall, that temptation is what pulls them into that darkness and creates this whole different and I almost said illusion, but I'm going to go with the word illusion of what is that, what is darkness and what is light. As I always think it's interesting that I think darkness really goes for those that are most vulnerable. And why in this metaphoric story of Adam and Eve, why did he choose Eve and not Adam?
Very true.
You know, somebody go, well, that's because she's the weaker sex. And I was like, I don't think it has anything to do with that. I think that at that point, that she was probably more open to thought at that, you know. And then I looked at it and I was like, where was Adam during this? He was diverted. His attention was someplace else. So if Adam and Eve had been together in that garden, would the serpent have had the same potential energy to bring in that darkness?
And it comes down to freedom of choice.
Freedom of choice. She had that choice. She had the option of to bite or not bite. And the same thing that, you know, it's kind of like, how do you tell the difference? How would have Eve known better that that was darkness? Because we're tempted all the time. How do we know what's evil and what's not evil? How would you define, we know what light is, but how do we define darkness? What's darkness? John.
Well, from different points of view and from different associations, you have to look at it as, like, if you're raised in darkness or lightness, and you're raised that way, you don't technically, like, see, one group will say, oh, well, they're the bad people, and the other group will say, well, they're the bad people. And it's completely, you know, it might be okay for you to, like, rule over lands, and then the other people over here say, no, that's not right, that's not fair, but they can't see it from the other side of the coin. And so when you look at it in a way of, well, are these people right or are these people right? Really, on the way, you have no idea, because it's just these people were told a certain way to do certain things, and these people were told a certain way to do certain things. And even one group won't even understand how the thinking process even happens over here, because they can't even acknowledge that line of thinking, because they were never taught that way. And then vice versa goes the other way. So when you're looking at it from two points of view, you don't know what, it's just two points of view.
That is interesting. And that goes back to what if I'm incorrect, guide me back to be on point. When I said some people are raised in light and they never know anything other than being in light, we treat each other with kindness, we live in a utopia, I wish I lived there. or if you're raised in darkness, and I'll give an example. There was a family that I saw, and the children were not products of incest. Okay, let me clarify that part. And I thought that this was kind of strange, but there was the client that came in with the family. This particular person was raised in a family where there was a lot of pedophilia and incest.
Wow.
And although they were not happy with that aspect of the family, there was not any kind of motion made to disconnect.
To change it.
So it was kind of like, because I remember at one time the person said, oh, I've got to go pick up my kids. They're over at grandma's house. And I'm thinking in my head, like, the grandma? And that was the grandmother that when this person was a child, that their parents would drop them off at grandma's house so the uncles could do whatever.
I want to touch on that too for just a minute. And I know it's going to be another topic for another day, but you know, when darkness sneaks in like
okay.
that and we allow darkness to overshadow that light, it feeds and it festers and it builds and it creates things into our environment, into our lives, and it manifests real things to happen.
Definitely.
Real dark energies, real dark entities into our lives. Things that often need help to get rid of.
But then going back to what John has said, but if you were raised in that, we on the outside in looking, going, oh, that's dark or that's wrong. But if they were raised in that belief, they don't see anything wrong with that at all.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with it.
It's natural.
You know, and even though this person was like, yeah, it's a little distasteful. I don't agree with it. And I don't think it's a good idea. And yes, it's traumatized me. But, you know, you're leaving your children over at the place where you were perpetrated all your life. Okay. So it's how, you know, they don't see that like we would see that as wrong. You know, I think that sometimes, you know, we, you know, pornography, you know, and they'll talk about pornography as a thing of darkness. Okay, well, I've seen some very beautiful nudes that I wasn't thinking about shagging anybody when I'm looking at it. And I'm like, oh my gosh, that's a beautiful piece of art, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's just gorgeous. Well, I might look at pornography and not think that's very artistic. And somebody else look at it and go, oh my God, that was the most artistic movie ever. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, Freddy on the Chain Gang. Okay. You know, I'm like, whatever. So you're right. You know, my version of darkness may not be your version of darkness or my version of going back to what you said.
Yeah.
So how is it? So what would we do to say to identify darkness? How would you, and John, you can't give me that same. How do you identify what is considered to be dark or darkness or evil? What would you consider?
Something that just makes you not feel right. Mm-hmm. You know, you can describe it anyway, in any way that you want. Lack of knowledge, or being knowledgeable, you know, I know for me, it's different than it is for someone else.
Okay. Well, let's talk about your experience with darkness.
Oh,
are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Cause this was intense.
It was very intense.
It was very, very intense.
But I think that I know that it happened for a reason. It doesn't make it that much easier.
Can I plug myself?
Yes.
For a second? Because I saw Tammy a couple of weeks. It was about a couple of weeks before you went on.
Before this.
But she went on a, what do you call them?
An investigation.
Okay, she goes on a paranormal investigation. So a couple of weeks before she goes, and we're just kind of chit-chatting, yakking, and I say a couple of things to her. I tell her, okay. She tells me that there's going to be some newbies on the trip, and I'm like,
watch out for one of the newbies.
Watch out for one of the newbies. And I'm just getting bad crap up in my head, and I'm trying to, like, make it seem like it's going to be all fine. And I'm like, oh, this newbie's going to, like, stir up some stuff here. I'm probably seeing a lot more of, like, them stirring a pot more than, you know, actually what had happened. And then what else did I say? There was something else.
Come see me right after the investigation.
Yeah. So come see me because there was something specific and I can't remember.
You had actually told me that one of the new investigators, something was going to happen.
Okay.
And boy, were you right?
Okay.
So, yeah.
I was watching part of it on the video because Kale did have it up on video, and I was like, "Hi, Jenny!" in the notes. Hi, like you could really see me saying hi. You know, Kale's got the phone. You're over on the other side. But I'm watching the video, and something happens, so I have to like step off or like disconnect or whatever. So take over. Tell me.
So
talk to us.
Usually, I'm a member of PIO here in Oklahoma, Paranormal Investigations of Oklahoma. A lot of times before we go do an investigation, I will get what I call a hot hit. I will feel prior to the investigation if there's a really bad, nasty, negative energy. That's why I said for me, it's different. Everybody can pick up on different energies, but for me, if it's nasty, I usually can tell. And that you and I actually talked about that because I had someone give me a warning before this very investigation. I wasn't picking up on anything. I had a different role at this particular investigation. I was actually team lead. So it was my job to be the lead investigator and look out for everyone else. Basically, I was in mama mode. I still had my feelers on, and anyway, the evening went really well. We get to the basement of one of the areas. It was the last building. For, you know, privacy sake of where we were, I'm not going to mention, but so the team owner, Kale, and myself, as soon as we walked into the basement, we both looked at each other because you could feel the energy in the room was extremely thick. And we started hearing these horrific screams and growls. And we couldn't believe what we were hearing. And they were obviously not human. Mm-hmm. We've heard enough screams like this to know that they were demonic. And so this went on for a good 2 to 3 minutes. And so we're trying to investigate the basement. We're walking around. And all of a sudden, I sat down on this bleacher bench. And I couldn't move. I didn't want to move. And one of the new investigators, she was standing directly in front of me, and so I kept my eye on them to see how she was doing. All of a sudden, I started getting very, very anxious. I started feeling anxiety. I kept smelling ammonia, this horrible, horrible ammonia smell. I couldn't breathe. And I looked up at the new investigator, and I asked her, I was like, "Are you okay?" And she just started shaking, and she was like, "I feel like I'm going to vomit." And I said, "Okay." So I got this flash in my third eye, and I knew right then that it was trying to attach to her. This entity that we had heard, the screaming, the growling. I felt her hands. Both of her hands were just like ice cubes. And I mean, it was warm outside, guys. I mean, there was no reason for her to be cold. So I jump up and I start to reach for my little book of prayers against darkness out of my bag. Kale starts to put his hands on her to pray. And as I'm searching in the darkness with my flashlight for the right prayer, we carry an ovulus around, and one of the words that came through the ovulus said, "Hurry." So it was mocking us. So I forgot the book, and I pulled out the holy water, put a hand on this girl to start praying, and spraying her with holy water. The nozzle on my bottle broke. It obviously did not want me to put holy water on her. So I put the bottle down, and I can feel my own anxiety from the spirit just coming at me because it did not like what we were trying to do. We were trying to intervene, and all I could do was pray. And then all of a sudden you could just feel the energy pull off of this girl, and it just shifted. Then you heard the word "burn" come across the ovulus, and I thought, okay, that was different. So she felt fine. You could just kind of really see everything from her body, just kind of like she just kind of went loose. So she stepped away. Kale stepped away. I sat down again because I just really did not have much left in me. And as I'm sitting there, I kept getting flashes and I got a vision and I saw teeth, horrible razor-shaped teeth. And I kept hearing gnashing of the teeth. And it was over and over and over again. And I started to get so emotional and I started to cry. And I told them, I said, guys, I can't stay in here. I'm getting emotional now. But usually I don't remember these visions.
Mm-hmm.
But this one was just really, really, really bad. And as soon as I saw the chomping, the word bite came over the ovulus. And I got up out of my seat and I was like, okay, guys, we gotta go. And then that anger just flushed over me again. And then all of a sudden I heard my angels and it was like, okay, Tammy, love, peace, and life. Love, peace, and light. And I had to just bring myself back into reality that, okay, this is a spiritual warfare here that I'm dealing with. And so I looked at Kale and I said, I've got some sage in my bag. And he's like, okay, let's sage. So I gave him some. I took some. He took one end. I took the other of the basement. We met in the middle. Then we saged everybody that was there. And then we left. The next day, I was exhausted. I was just completely wiped out. I got ready to take a shower. And as soon as I took off my shirt, I had a huge burn mark right in the center of my chest over my heart. And 3 scratches on my belly. And then it took me back to what I heard on the ovulus, burn. So Monday morning, I came in here, made a beeline to Linda because Monday I lost 4 hours of time and I knew that I needed more intervention than what I could do myself. And I continued my prayers and saging. Linda, you helped me. I got myself cleared, grounded, and refocused, and my angels told me for sure that it was definitely spiritual warfare.
Oh, yeah.
I did speak to Kale, and he, too, received a burn. He had a burn on his leg and 2 marks that almost resembled bite marks on his arm, his left arm. I did not let it win. But I know that it's going to be a mark on me as a reminder that I'm doing what I know that God has planned for me to do. Just like what I said at the beginning, it doesn't, you know, light will always overcome darkness. It doesn't mean that darkness is not going to do everything in its power to come at you
mm-hmm.
and try to put up one hell of a good fight. It's going to try. But I already know that we won. So.
Oh, definitely. Well, you know, it's kind of like I laugh and I go, I know how the book ends,
yeah.
you know,
so,
you know, we're always, light will always supersede and light will always overcome.
Yeah. It doesn't mean that we don't walk away with battle wounds because I sure did.
Oh, definitely. 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 I think we do walk away with a lot of battle wounds
yeah.
on that. You know, that's, you know, when you sit there and you think about the whole concept of spiritual warfare and how much is not seen by the naked eye or by the closed eye, as I said, and that's why, you know, it's like people will like to mock often about, oh yeah, whatever, and I'm like, let me just tell you, demons exist.
They do.
You know, demons come and go, you know, and I think demon is, I'm just going to use it like the word Kleenex.
Right.
You know, so demon can be anything that is of a negative intention, a negative purpose, a negative energy, a negative vibe. You know, we can create we can create a negative entity just from our thoughts and our mind, believe it or not. And, you know, going back to when, you know, I call it night school, and it's something that Richard Gerber taught in vibrational healing. And he would say to his students and followers, and he would say, you know, we're working in a very spiritual world. And he was a physician, an MD, an internal med, but he believed in vibration and frequency and that spiritual experience with it. And he would, you know, talk about that often, and how that we are easily affected, and if we can create disease with our mind. You know, think about the person who is so focused on cancer and the signs and symptoms. I don't ever want to have cancer. Cancer. They literally say cancer 100 times a day sometimes. And then lo and behold, you know, Yule Gibbons. Remember Yule Gibbons back when we were kids? Heartland Natural Valley cereal.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. He's eating all of these healthy foods and healthy cereals, and dude ends up with rectal cancer. Okay. You bring that vibration in, and I think that even with like negative entities, that if you're focused on something so negative, that's what's going to happen, is that you're going to create this negative vibe, whether it's got a name that you can find in scripture, or, you know, or in some, you know, Enochian book, or is this, you know, and I'm going to throw this out. Is this a Slender Man projection?
Right.
You know, it was funny because I had this dream, you know, in night school. And so in night school, going back to what Dr. Gerber said, he says, you're taught, you know, before you go to bed, you're like, okay, spirit, Holy Spirit, whatever you want to call it. I'd like to go to night school. Take me, you know, in my sleep time, and teach me what I need to know about the spiritual world. And if you choose to do this, let me ask you to please put the clause in. And when I wake up in the morning, I'm fresh.
Right.
As if I'd slept an 8-hour night.
And you are
and
protected.
Peacefully. And you are protected,
yes.
You know, during this. And so you can go to night school. So I go to night school one night, you know, like a month ago. And there's a imam that I follow on Twitter. It's Imam Muhammad Tahiti. Or they call him the Imam of Peace, and he's a Shia Muslim. And so he does a lot of spiritual teaching, you know, into the whole concept of the Islamic belief. And he's very, very pro-Christian, does a lot of interdenominational stuff. Well, he's teaching in my night class, and I'm like, holy cow, here's Imam Muhammad Tahiti, and he's teaching in the spiritual realm. And in my dream, you know, when I'm in night school, he's like talking about the different demonic entities. And then he looks at me, because I mean, that's like, he looks towards me in my dream, and he's like laughing, kind of, he's got a smile on his face, and he has his finger pointing, you know, and he's like pointing at me, kind of like shaking the finger, but not negatively. And he's like, and you need to stay away from those fourth dimensionals. So Slender Man, I cannot deal with. Anything else, but I can't with the fourth dimensional. So if you've created something in your head, don't come see me. I'm just joking when I say that. I'm joking, you know. I will make sure that that whoever is gifted to take care of your needs, you know, I will definitely get that person in. I would never tell somebody no. But, you know, when you start thinking about it, so what do you now define? You know, and I was like, so anything, to me, darkness is of anything that is of a negative intent.
Exactly.
You know.
I agree with that. I like that definition.
You know, it was like anything of a negative intent. And I was like, at one time, Lucifer was well loved.
He was.
And I think, and I'm going to say this, and I'm probably going to have tons of Christian groups come and like hang me on this one. And I think that God still loves him.
He does.
And I
just like the angels that were, you know, fallen angels, hell's angels. You know, they all had and have the opportunity to repent for their sins. We all do.
And that's when I was like, some people that are born in light, or, you know, whatever, that go into the darkness and then come back. I'm like, I'm a prodigal child. I've been in the darkness, you know, and I was like, I've seen the demons. I've played with demons, you know, I've done these crazy, horrible things. But I was like, light is so much easier. Let me just tell you, the workload is easy in the light. You can't see in the dark.
Right.
You can't see it.
Well, you had an encounter not so long ago yourself here in the building as well.
Yes, I did. And it's all about the same time frame.
Yeah.
That you're preparing for yours.
Yeah.
And I think mine happened the week before.
Yeah.
The week before. And actually, I'm going to bust Aileen on this too. there was something else that had occurred. As we're working on a lot of really groovy things. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things that had occurred was I get this crazy bite on my hand, and I'm watching as this bite is occurring, and there's nothing biting me. I can feel a tingling in my wrist. I look down at my wrist, and I'm watching it as two puncture wounds come up. I mean, and they're like puncture wounds, folks. And then they create this pustule on it, and I'm just sitting here watching it, and I'm like, well, I guess someone's doing a little voodoo again. Notice I said again, because I've been down that road with this before. And so I, you know, didn't think too much of it because I don't believe in that. You know, one of the things about some of the darkness is that there has to be a level of belief
right.
in order for it to truly manifest out. And so, you know, I'm like, well, I rebuke that one, you know, and let me just tell you, 5 days later, I spike a fever and I am like really, 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 really sick for like 2 days. And during that time, I'm hallucinating. I have a period of lucid moment and I'll text you real quick. And then I'm like out there in La La Land again. And there was things that came to me during that time and information that was shared with me during that time. The next day I wake up and I'm all right. And then now you can see my battle wound is healed.
Mm-hmm.
But Aileen and I are talking about this, and I'm like, girl, the craziest thing happened, you know, when I was out. And so she lifts up her shirt and she starts showing me the very same puncture wounds that I have on my wrist, which I'm going to let you know is right by the radial artery. So this entity had it out for me. So anyway, she's got the very same puncture wounds, but they're bigger, but the same ratio in between them and et cetera. If you know, did the size difference, that's the thing being a nurse and you know how to convert ratios really quick.
Right.
And so, and I'm looking at her and she's looking at me and we're like, what the heck? And I'm like, hey, we're doing something they don't like. So then the in between all of this is with the one that you're referring to, Tammy. Is there is a person that comes in, and when they come in, I have my friend Terry is there, and there's some new people that I had never met before. One of these chicks, and I'm looking at this chick going, you need to go. Can I buy some stones? You need to go. Can I buy some stones? So I sell her the stones, right? And I'm like trying to manage this person that obviously has something with them. And I'm telling you what, they are like rolling the tongue. They are writhing on the floor. They're doing all sorts of bizarre stuff. She starts calling off all of the Alice in Wonderland stuff. And those of you that are into conspiracy theories, you know what I'm talking about on the Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about. Okay, and so she's going off on all this stuff, and she's got this necklace. And so the necklace is part of this thing here. And so anyway, it's a very trippy time. And I get down the stairs with this person, and I start calling out and rebuking and trying to call this out. And I literally had to throw them out the door and lock the door. You have to, one thing that people need to understand that when you are working in that spiritual world and you're doing spiritual warfare, you've got your, you know, that Ephesians 6, 10 through 20, you know, I'm taking it out past the 17. We're going all the way into the whole shingle doodly. So you've got your battle guard on and everything. Is that if somebody has a negative attachment or a negative vibe to them and they choose that they want to hold on to that vibe, you're wasting your time.
Yeah, you're not going to get rid of it.
You're not going to get rid of it. You're wasting your time. And so now when folks show up with the entities, if they are not willing to release that entity, I will not see them. And I think that's very important, because why would you want to, and this is, you know, and so she kind of, this person comes back to me a couple of days later and they're like apologetic for it. And, you know, and they're like dissing it off on one thing. And I'm like, no, you need to stop dancing with the demons. And when you're ready to release those and not be a part of that, come back. Until then, please don't come back.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, this, we're a spiritual ER. down here. But here's the deal. If you're not willing to let go of that, don't. And I don't want to sound like I'm not a loving person, because I will pray for you. I will meditate for you. I will smudge you. I will do anything that you feel like you need that day. But don't bring your demon here if you're not willing to get a divorce from it.
Well, because at that point, people get hurt. You as the practitioner get hurt.
Which, you know.
Yeah.
You've experienced that.
Well.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and myself and Kale and other members on our team, we know what to do because we've done this before.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that you're not going to take on certain things. But people can honestly, truly get hurt. And then you can also run the risk of walking away with an attachment yourself. And so you have to know what to do to prevent that, or watch for certain signs to make sure that if something's off with yourself, you go get help. Just like your words came back to me, come see me right after the investigation.
Yeah.
And I did. So, yeah.
And you know, and I would, and I'm sitting here kind of giggling in my head going, here, I'm going to boost my business. All right, ghost hunters. after your session, you need to come see me. You know, I understand you, you know, but seriously, I mean, think about it. Every good psychiatrist has a psychiatrist.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's kind of like, okay, I'm going to go and do this. I've got to debrief body, mind, and spirit. And I think that that is something that is very important, because when there was a story that, about people that have been in this business for a long time, or maybe not a long time, but very intensely, that it ages them.
Yes.
And it wears their body, their mind, their spirit down. So it's, you know, I'm trying to think if there's some jackhammers. People that run jackhammers are only allowed to do it for 5 years, and then they have to retire.
Yeah,
I believe that.
My brother-in-law went to go work up in Minnesota, and he on a road crew, and he did the jackhammer, and he said part of that, because it was some kind of like a DOT or, mm-hmm. you know, a federal thing. It was through the Indian tribes, and he was saying that they're only allowed to do the jackhammer for 5 years, and then they have to retire off of that,
mm-hmm.
and that, so you work your 5 years, and then you retire, you get retirement money. You got to do your whole 5 years, but then you're retired and you get full benefits, you know, plus your salary, you know, for eons after that. And I was like, I think the same thing happens, is that if people aren't taking care of themselves after battling or working in that darkness, they have to, because they have to go in and debrief.
Yes.
They have to detox or clear or cleanse or whatever you want to call it afterwards. Because if you don't, you're going to end up sick. You're going to end up curing those entities.
Yeah.
Because when I was a part of the darkness, and I worked in the darkness, when I worked doing readings and et cetera for people, and people would go, oh my God, those are hellacious readings. Well, no, they're hellacious. Guess where they came from? You know? you know, you think about it and it's like, dang, I was taxed. I was really, really, really ill. And it wasn't until I came back to the light and started cutting off all that stuff. I still do readings, but I don't do the same kind of readings,
mm-hmm.
you know? And then even now, even over the last 5 years, my light has changed. my light that I was where I was 5 years ago is not the light today.
Right.
Because I have learned that you have to do these things and that you cannot engage, you cannot embrace. And so it's, you know, often, you know, I feel like for me in being a very, what I'm going to call a hardcore Christian, I'm not a Bible thumper. I'm not like, you're going to burn in hell, because I don't believe in some of those concepts that, you know, I look back at the old scripture, the Aramaic stuff. So I'm not too much into the King James. Just don't tell my husband. But, you know, darkness it can come in many, many, many forms. I mean, it can be a business that's aggressive and so aggressive that they forget about the consumer. Think about Big Pharma on some of the medications that they developed, and they were so hot to get these things out. And I don't think it was to save the world. I think it was to make a buck. And you can come get me on that one too. But if you know, and so what do? They go out there with this medication and they pump this medication out to the public. And then we find out 3 years later, oh yeah, it's going to have all these detrimental effects on, you know, your DNA or the development of your kids' gonads. And, you know, I'm thinking about that, the HPV injection, the Gardasil. I always want to call it the little bacterial infection or amoeba infection that you get from beavers.
Right.
Or guardiolas or whatever. And I'm like, no, it's not the same thing. You know, it's beavers, but, you know, beaver, right? And so you look at it and I was like, is that not part of darkness? When you go out and you put a medication that you know hasn't been tested appropriately and you give it to the public, is that not a thing of darkness? You know, what about in Flint, Michigan, when they've gone for how many years with contaminated, nasty, lead-filled water that they're giving their population? And you think, is that not darkness?
Yeah, you know, the intention that's behind it.
The intention. Somebody was, you know, sitting there talking, I think their comment to me was that our current administration does not care about the environment. And I was like, I believe that I remember back from 2016 when the Flint water was such a hot topic that our current Congress, most of them, now not the ones that were elected in 18, but our current Senate and House voted to wait until after the election. This was in July. They're pissed off about Trump being nominated for the presidential on the Republican, but they voted to wait until after the election to readdress anything in Flint, and they still hadn't done jack. Is that darkness?
Yeah. Meanwhile,
people are dying. Kids, especially kids. So darkness doesn't have to be in the form of horns and a tail and a pitchfork.
Right.
You know, darkness can be whatever our intention is. And one of the, going back to what Father had written in that book, was that, you know, that's pretty much a truth.
Oh, yeah.
That dark, you know, you don't have to be, you're not always demonically possessed because you played with a Ouija board. Or that you, you know, said, Baal, come kiss me, or, you know, whatever. That just by your negative intentions and choices can create that entity.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, in businesses, it happens all the time. We're so focused on that dollar bill that we forget what that represents, what our mission is in that. And I was like, I think we see that often in business. I think we see it in politics. I think we see it in entertainment. Everybody wants to have this movie that everybody wants to go and see, and it's going to be a zillion-dollar blockbuster, and they'll go to at any cost any consequence in order to get that created and out that door. And there's several movies that come out, and I'm like, I sure hope that those don't make, because they're very dark. They have very dark concepts.
Yeah.
and ideas. And I think often people watch those movies and they create. I'll never forget the time my kids were like, oh, Mom, there's this really cool movie called Hostel. And I'm like, oh, hostels. Those are those places that people stay when they're over in Europe, and they're kind of inexpensive. And it's like, it's really groovy adventure. And so I'm like, cool, I'll go with you. You know, I don't pay attention to the poster or anything like that. So we go in and we're watching Hostel, and, you know, Hostel starts to turn into more hostile. And I'm like, holy cow. And I'm looking at my sons and they're like digging it. And I'm like, I just want to put my hands over their eyes and go, you don't need this stuff. This is the devil at work. And I was, and I, and so after the movie, I was like, you guys realize that people do stuff like that. And I'm like, no, seriously, people do stuff like that. How is that entertainment? I was listening on Twitter, Tammy, you know, I love my Twitter, you know, so every once in a while I watch the live videos. And it always comes back and it says, does art imitate life or does life imitate art? So the movies that we're creating that are very disturbing, is that imitating life, or do the things that happen in life imitate that? Because in many ways, we glorify darkness.
Yeah, I think so.
We embrace it.
Playing.
Now, I was reading something, and I don't know, have y'all ever seen the show Lucifer? The first time, I've only watched, like, a little bit of it. I turned it on one night not knowing what it was, and it was a Rage in the Cage song, and it was one that I liked. So I'm like, oh my God, I love this song. And so I'm, like, listening to it, and I'm like, yeah, you know. And next thing you know, it's like, this guy's name is Lucifer. And I'm like, Lucifer? Who the hell would name their kid Lucifer? People do. Yeah. And then I realized, oh, this is Lucifer. Now he's like talking. They're like, oh, your dad's calling. I'm thinking, it's Satan. Okay, so I just watch it for a little bit. And I'm like, nah, I'm good. You know, I'll change it to something else. I don't like that channel anyway. And I'm reading and something on Twitter. And they're talking about the show Lucifer. When I think it was Dr. Blumenthal or somebody was talking about it. And they said that God was Lucifer's father in this show. And I'm like, why would God be calling Lucifer at his titty bar? Just want to know. I think he said it. I think he, you know, and I'm kind of like, you know, I'm over here and I'm like, they've really, really messed up the perception of what this is. So it's like, I'm seeing Hollywood is now making where we're told that Lucifer is probably not your best friend.
I'm saying
they're making him into an owner of a bar, and he's hot.
Bring MGM here. We can do a podcast. We can definitely entertain. Come on now. We can give him some truth to put on TV.
Thank you.
I'm just saying.
Well, touched by an angel, man.
All right.
Give me some Della Reese and some Rona Downey.
I love that show.
Oh, my God.
Growing up, I loved it.
I'm like, Sunday nights on MeTV were like, I'm watching it. I loved it.
Do we have an opportunity on this to where, you know, our viewers could maybe tell us somehow if there was a topic that they had?
Oh, we can definitely start putting that buzz out. And we are always delighted to talk about things.
Absolutely.
You know, John, you've been really quiet. Do I talk too much? Okay, I think
I've just been listening because there's certain things I can say and certain things I can't
say. So tell us some things that you can say about this. I mean, what are some of the things that have come up that you're like, I don't think so.
Talking with about the movies and entertainment, it's all based off of a certain emotion frequency that's given off during the movie. And when you get involved in the movie, you have an emotional response to it. And when you have an emotional response to it, that's when a door is opened. Because back through history, certain religions, but certain rituals were done to create certain emotions in the body. And when the certain emotion is created, whether it's a high extreme bliss or an extreme rage, you have it on both ends, it opens a door. It's for a brief fraction of a second. And you can actually throw an intent out that window. And it cannot be received. Once it's out there, it's out there. And you're going to get whatever comes back. So whatever your intention was will come back. But there's always consequences with that.
Oh, definitely, definitely, definitely. Designated survivor. I saw a tweet, and I'm a tweeter, and on there they marked that there were 10 particular things that they covered in that season, and every single one of them would be what I would call a negative vibe, and it was something that they were trying to induce through their programming from the public. I mean, they were talking about, you know,
Well, when you, like, if you watch a TV show or a movie and you say to yourself, oh, I relate to that person.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you just put yourself in that emotional state, that frequency, for you to create more of the circumstances that maybe is happening on that program.